the first century Sadducees under Judaism, they believed that if you was wealthy and healthy, just like some folk do today, that now God bless you, that God was for you. So if you were oppressed and you were poor and all of that, that God wouldn't for you. How many really know that you can love God with all your heart and you still can be poor? You still got a lot of people in the body of Christ, they love the Lord. But their minds haven't been renewed to know what his word says to release faith in it. So that they can get the results that God wants us to get and have through his word that has been established from heaven. Amen? So that word, beatitude, derived from a Latin word, which means blessed. And we say that word blessed means what? Empowered to prosper. What else? Huh? You cannot fail. Huh? Victorious. We are more than a conqueror. Huh? Fulfilled. Victorious. More than conquerors. We also discuss when you look at Matthew's account about Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, it should take us back to Moses coming down. After he had went up on what mountain? Moses went up on what mountain to get the commandments? What was the name of that mountain? Mount Sinai. Moses met with the Lord, and God did what he inscribed in stone. What he expected the people to be doing. Okay? Hey, here it is. This is the difference right here. Now, don't you misunderstand what the Spirit of God is getting ready to say. When God gave Moses the law put the people in a position that they should come to the end of themselves, and put their trust totally in him. Because without him, here it is now, you need to hear this right. Without him, they could not accomplish what he told them to do anyway. Here it is. Now, the law brings us to the end of ourselves, but grace takes us to the beginning of God. Y'all gotta catch that. Hey, glory. In other words, our dependency should never be in who we are. Talk to me now. But in the one that we propose to worship and serve. So bless you. So when Moses was given the law, we understand the first five books of the Bible is called the Pentateuch or the Torah. The Torah was explaining to the people what God expected their relationship to be with him. There it is. So when Jesus went up on the Mount of Olives and started teaching the Beatitudes, the attitudes to be, he was telling the people, this is the relationship that I expect you to have with me. Through me to the Father. Because I'm the representation of the invisible, unseen God that you you can't see. I am that express image right here. And so I'm giving you what you need. How is it? And I'm still puzzled with this, Pastor Waller. I'm still puzzled with this. So many people say that they have a relationship with the Lord, but we don't want to spend no time in the Word. We don't want to spend no time in and with the Word. There's a lot of reasons, but if we just could sum it up with a phrase, and y'all have heard this a lot this year, so many people, Mo, they ain't after God's heart. They're after his hand. Because most people, whether saved or not, they only fellowship when they need something. And after God did finish with his finished with God, put it back on the shelf. But tune in, their backs up against the wall, between the wall and the hard place. Right back. God got all these false accusations we make on God. Because we don't have no word nor no understanding about who God is. And so Jesus started teaching. He started teaching on the Mount of Olives. The Sermon on the Mount is called. And he said, this is what the Father expects. See, here it is now. When we're reading this, don't get so caught up in the first part of it. Because the whole counsel of God is good. But he's making some powerful statements of what he is expecting the believer, the citizen, during his time of the Word becoming flesh. Are y'all still here? And so the first century Sadducees, they believed that if you were wealthy and healthy, God was for you. And Jesus came and crushed that ideology. I say Jesus showed up and crushed it. Because we still have people teaching philosophy and ideology that is not built on the foundation of Christ. It's not. What Paul say? Do y'all read it in Galatians? Paul said, if you're preaching the other gospel, that'll be what? Huh? This is Paul that got so much revelation that Paul said something that he was shown when he was taken or was spoken in the third heaven. He said it wouldn't even lawful for him to even come back in this realm and even utter it out of his mouth. But Paul said, you will never find me boasting. Ah, glory. And we still got some folks today that lack the boast. And you tell me you got more revelation. I ain't saying that the Spirit of God can't take you farther than it took Paul. Good God Almighty. Paul said, if I'm going to boast in anything, it's going to be in my infirmity. God Almighty. Y'all better talk to me now. Because most of the time when we do get infirmity, we stop. We ain't thinking about boasting. We too busy complaining. Woe is me, Lord. Lord said, no. Go do as a good soldier. He said, go through. See, if you get the law, if you get what my word says, you can endure hardship as a good soldier. Don't feel good. God Almighty. Don't seem like it's good, but hey, it's working for your good and it's working for my good. We just gotta find what's good in it. And if you think that the hellhounds of the kingdom of darkness is just going to let you and I walk into our promised land without any confrontation, without any restriction, just not going to do it. Tell somebody you got to have the word. Tell somebody you have to have the word. And the word have to have you. It's just like faith. We have to have faith, and faith has to have us. Hot tomato. Because what use is having faith if faith really don't have us? Come on, talk to me now. Talk to me. And when you mix those two together, good God, oh Zion, faith in the word will get you the promises of God. Where's that? Where's God? Help the Holy Spirit. In one area, some of y'all probably can help the Holy Spirit bring it back to my remembrance, but some of y'all might not. He said, because it wasn't mixed with faith. Y'all remember that area of the scripture? See, it has to be mixed. All right, now, I don't want you to stay back there too long. Y'all remember them mixed drinks we used to drink? In other words, you had to have some grapefruit juice with some of that hard-hitting stuff. Come on. It had to be mixed. So here it is. Come on. You got a mixed faith in the word together in order to walk in the promise. Y'all talking with me. I don't want you to stay back there too long. Don't stay there too long now. Amen. So Jesus is teaching on the Mount of Olives, and he's releasing this teaching. All right, this is after chapter 4. Now I want y'all just go back a little bit. We're gonna degress. Chapter 4. All right. Chapter 4, and I want somebody to pick up from verse 12 and read all the way through to verse 25. Because if you know where Jesus is at now, you must also remember where he's been, where he has been. All right? Somebody start reading that verse number 12.
He departed to Galilee, and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, "The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles."
Of who? Of the Gentiles. Where did he go dwell? Of the Gentiles. I think he read verse 16.
The people who sat in darkness
have seen a great light. So why is it, I'm still trying to grasp it, so much light is in the earth, and yet people are still in darkness? Think about it now. Think about it. They love darkness more than they do coming to the light. Now Matthew's giving this account. He said, a bright light. That's Christ. He's a great light. Keep reading, Pastor Waller.
And upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light was dawn.
Oh, look, not only did they sit in darkness, he said, upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. Keep reading.
From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand."
Read verse 17 again. Y'all grab this now. Read verse 17 again. What it says?
From what time?
It said what?
Jesus began to preach
saying,
"Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand."
Jesus They left their boats and their household and began to follow him. Need y'all to pick up on something now. Need y'all to pick up on our journey up back to the Sermon on the Mount. Okay? Alright? Verse 17 says, from that time, after he heard that John the Baptist was in prison, he began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has arrived, or is near, or is at hand. That's what that word at hand means. Has arrived, or is near. Okay? Then he said, after verse 17, read verse 18 again, Pastor Waller. You got somebody else?
And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, that's...
Okay. You're right.
And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter,
okay, what happened in verse 19?
Then he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. They immediately left their nets and followed him.
Stop right there. Alright? Okay. Jesus didn't come up with no gimmicks. He didn't have no game. He had what the Father had sent him with to give to them. Now, the scripture don't tell us how long he talked with them. But he had a conversation with Peter and Andrew. Right? Peter and Andrew. Andrew, the brother Peter. And whose sons were they? Did he ever say whose sons they were? But it never say who Peter and Andrew followed us? Okay. So here he is. Y'all catch this right here. Peter and Andrew had a fisher business. A fishery business. Instructed them to do a specific thing. ordered them to do. He wouldn't even allow them to store up for the next day because he never wanted their dependency to be in what he gave them. Y'all better talk to me. And so even if they did try to store it up, he allowed certain things to get in. So they couldn't. I shout out. Sometimes God will get into some stuff. And it's not the devil. It's God getting into some stuff so that you won't put your dependency in what you are storing up. Okay, all right. Okay, all right. I know that wouldn't go over well. Because some of us are so tight, we still squeak when we walk. And you start storing up stuff because you really don't have the faith that you say you have. So you start storing up stuff. So for a rainy day, now I'm not saying we should be good stewards. Don't misinterpret that. But if your dependency is more than what you saved up, than what God has said he'll do in your life, then you better check your priorities. Oh, boy. Peter and Andrew immediately left their nets and their international fishery business. Here it is. They gave up their business for the kingdom's glory of God. Ha! Well, I want to say something, but the Holy Ghost won't let me. Oh, do I want to say something? Y'all just don't know how bad I want to say it. He's desiring for us to give up some stuff. Because we really haven't weighed the balance yet that we say we have. We really have. Because we still think what we see, what we have, is more than what he said unseen. Hey! God, don't do me like this. Now just don't tell me out there. Don't. We ain't weighing the balance yet because if we have somehow, glory to God, you just don't know what I got. No, God knows what's on your plate. And the thing of it is, if Peter and Andrew, I ain't even got to Zebedee's sons, if Peter and Andrew could leave their fishing, international fishery business, and just drop the nets, leave the boat and follow Jesus. He must have said something that trumped everything that they had been doing, and we don't know how long they had been fishing because the scripture don't say it. But I can tell you one thing. I believe Peter and Andrew were some good fishermen. What did y'all see there? Because I don't want the Holy Spirit to allow to move too fast. What did y'all see that caused Peter and Andrew, brothers now, and good brothers, because they had a fishery business together. See, sometimes brothers can't do nothing together. Y'all ain't catch that. Hey, glory! But what caused them? Because both of them was in it together. And Jesus had a conversation with them about the kingdom. And they dropped everything and began to follow him. What do y'all, let y'all spiritual imagination to go down the portals of time and draw something. I ain't talking just making up anything. But what is the Spirit giving you to cause Peter and Andrew to drop? See, because y'all getting caught up in the nets in the boat. But you got to understand that fishery business that they had, it was international. Good God Almighty. And those brethren, they dropped everything. Here it is, for the one thing. They had everything. See, sometimes we can't wrap our thinking around that because we ain't used to thinking that one thing has everything. Because we got too many things that don't have everything, and we got a whole lot of things without everything. Y'all catch that later on.
dead. And it was no doubt they just went on. I mean, there was no question. Talk, Pastor.
One thing was,
good tea. Good.
You have to remember this. Andrew had come back to Peter and said, we have found the Messiah.
Uh-oh.
He had already told him.
Uh-oh.
Now when Jesus comes along, okay, and he approaches him, I don't know what he said.
Of course.
Whatever he said.
Yes, sir.
It agreed with Peter's spirit to the point that Peter was willing to give up everything. Now remember, Peter had a family.
Yes, sir.
But for him to give up his business, walk away from his business to follow Jesus, it had to be something he had to feel that this is the Messiah. This is the one we've been waiting for all along. We've been waiting for him all along.
Said so far. Now, even though he came from Nazareth, you got to keep that in mind. Because they said, get in a good thing. Even though we understand that they are saying that he's the Messiah, but we might just know him as Mary and Joseph's son. And see, you and I have to be careful who we listen to. Peter embraced what Andrew said. Uh-oh, y'all catch it now. Here it is. And also, understanding that now he was the Messiah, also a rabbi. The word of the Lord in 3,000 souls. just like that. This same Peter that Jesus said that the Satan had desired to sift you as wheat. Here it is. And he said, but I have prayed for you. And he told Peter, he said, and after, or once you've been what? Y'all talk to me now. What does scripture say? Once you've been converted. He said, then you can go strengthen your brother. Y'all better. So we still got a lot of one of these that really haven't been converted. So that's another part that answer your question, why people. See, here it is, because we're using Jesus for just fire insurance from hell. Okay. Because everybody tell you, because they don't understand this, the problem of sin has already been dealt with, and so they tell you, yeah, you keep on doing what you do, you going straight to hell. And so you say, I got just for fire insurance. I'm a believer. But when somebody look at your life, see that word in Acts 1, when you are true witness, that word witness means mortal. That means that you are dying. God told God. See, it headed, Pastor Marlena. It's amazing that these people that are under Islam, that they are dying for a lie. But we won't die for the truth. I'm trying to hate myself. They have become a mortal for a lie. And we want for the truth. And Jesus said, if you will follow me, come on here now. I know we talked about it in Matthew 16:24 last week. Jesus said, if you will follow me, come on now. He said, you will have to do something first. Hey, he said, somebody got to die. He said, and you can't afford to die without me. Oh, have mercy. He said, but if you lose your life for my name's sake, then you'll find life. But if you try to save your life, he said, you will lose it. Peter, Andrew, follow me. Here it is. If he can get us to get on the same path that he's on, eventually we're going to be persuaded to be convicted by him that we don't just want to follow him. We want everything that he has to offer. Come on, y'all. So after we get past chapter 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and get to 13, Jesus start talking to them differently. The disciples, that is. He start putting them in categories. He said, it has been given to you. He said, it has already been given to you to know the mystery of the kingdom of heaven. He said, but to them, two categories. And sometimes people get mad with you, even, because you gave up everything and they're still struggling. God, here it is, Augusta. Here it is. And Augusta, they might have more than we do, but yet we ain't struggling in that area. Because we already been convinced to be convicted, to be converted. That he shall. See, you got to have the word. He shall supply. He shall. He didn't say, I might. He said, he shall supply our every need. Huh? So automatically, I got to put in the equation that God is more than enough. In spite of what it looked like I have not in my life. So what I'm looking at in my life, it might look diametrically opposed to what he said. God Almighty.
But the not seen is eternal. And so we get stuck sometimes because I'm trying to add up what I can see. Verse what he said. And every time you take what you can see, verse what he said, you can't see what I said. Because if you don't see what I said, you can't look at what you see. You gotta look at what I said so you can see what I said. Because your focus is on what I said, not what you see. I know this sounds elementary, but the Spirit of God is helping some of y'all here tonight.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. Oh, glory. And he said, now to you all, it has been given to know. And when you know, you ain't got to worry about it. When it look like you in one of your most difficult trials, this will help somebody. When it look like you in one of your most difficult trials, and everybody is on the sideline, deep in front, looking at you to see how you want to respond. But they ain't looking for your response, they looking for your reaction.
Yeah.
But the head is, you're cool and calm in the service.
Let me
fast. For what the Lord gave me to do for his people.
Yes.
See, because what happened is, when we see the people oppressed, even in our fellowship, when we see the people being oppressed at the expense of people going up because of the people, and not all of them going up together, God said, if you won't stand for what's right, you will fall for anything. And so when somebody God raised up to make a difference, everybody ain't gonna like it.
That's right.
And it's not the individual making a difference, it's God through the individual.
Yes.
But you gotta be that guy. I'm going to the king unannounced. And if the king don't invite you in, good God Almighty, it's just like committing suicide. That's a death sentence. Hallelujah. But ask us, say, I'm going. Hey, I'm going. I'm going. Y'all better catch it. I'm going to see the king. Yeah. I'm going to see him unannounced. But because I got such favor with him, hey, glory. I got such favor with him. Hey, glory. He's going to understand I don't break the protocol. I don't break the protocol, so he will know it's a desperate situation. Hey, glory. When was the last time you stood in between as a mediator, as an intercessor, and standing in the gap for somebody else? Not for you, but for somebody else. What Jesus was doing, he said, I understand those sad you see. They are very sad you see. And they got the wrong theology. Their ideology is totally off. And they believe because they are wealthy and healthy that God is just for them. And all of these oppressed people that are poor, he think that God don't care nothing about them. And he said, I'm going, hey, Peter, come here, Peter. You and Andrew, come here, I'm going to make y'all some fishers of me. Are y'all still here?
Yeah.
I'm going to make you some fishers. But I will need you to follow me so you can be converted. Here it is. I'm going to give you my law. I'm going to give you my word. I'm going to give you my Pentateuch, Torah. This is what I'm going to do. Here it is. And here it is. I have to change the way y'all have been thinking from, here it is, that religion called Judaism, to now understanding kingdom. Oh, y'all die. Now, go, keep reading now. No, I tell you what. Yeah, keep reading. Sorry, 19. Still in chapter 4, 19. We got to go.
Then he said to them.
Then he said to who?
To them.
What did he say?
They immediately left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers.
Uh-oh, here we go. Now, here we go.
James, the son of Zebedee, and John,
brother
in the boat of Zebedee, their father, mending their nets.
They were in the boat with their father.
He called to them, and immediately they left the boat and their father.
Good God Almighty. Keep reading. God, I can't get started. Read that verse again. What did he do?
Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogue, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people.
Read that again.
And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogue, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people.
What verse is that?
Verse 23.
Y'all make sure y'all highlight that. Make sure you highlight that. Read it one more time if somebody didn't hear it.
And Jesus went about all Galilee.
Hold on. And Jesus went about. That means he didn't stay in one place. He went about. In all disciple is made by a teacher. And what that happened to the local body of Christ is that we've been preached to be inspired that we never got taught. And so we really don't know how to be a student or a learner of what now Jesus taught. And so we buy all of these feel-good messages. God Almighty. Ha! He first taught. He taught them. If you will be my disciple, he said, that word disciple is not only a follower. That word disciple means that you are a student or you are a learner. From the master teacher, the rabbi himself, Jesus the Christ. Are y'all still here? So he taught, and what else did he do?
Preaching the gospel of the kingdom.
Okay, he said, now I'm going to preach the gospel of the kingdom. Now, here it is. You gotta make sure you watch the order. He taught. He preached the gospel of the kingdom. And when the gospel of the kingdom has been preached and taught, guess what comes after? Demonstration of his power. The demonstration of the power of what he was talking about. The government. The government of his kingdom. Did y'all catch that? He said he preached the gospel of the kingdom. Then what else did he preach? What else did he do?
And healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people.
He healed all kinds of sickness and disease of the people. He said all kind. All kind. Okay, somebody help us by the Spirit here. When you start dealing with all kind of sickness and disease, where does that originate from? What's the origin of sickness and disease? So see, we need to get an understanding of this. Somebody help us. Somebody help us. Somebody help us. Come on, y'all. Come on. Come on. It says he did what? We read that out part again. What did he do?
And healed all kinds of sickness.
He healed all kinds of sickness and diseases. All kinds. Y'all remember one place in Matthew's, it probably was in some other gospels too, where the father bought the son that had this spirit. That would send him in convulsions and throw him in the fire. And he'd be foaming from the mouth. And he brought him to Peter and the disciples. And they could not do anything with that kind. I need y'all to focus on kind. That kind. And when he brought him to Jesus, and Jesus just dealt with that kind. What did Jesus say to the disciples when they asked him why they couldn't? He said, this kind. He said, this kind.
manipulating spirit to think that now, when you fast and you pray, that now God is going to do something. Now, hold on now. When you fast and pray, it brings us up to the level that God said we should be. So when we deal with that kind, God Almighty. So we can deal with that kind. But where, most of it, where's the origin of sickness and disease? Where does it come from? Come on, y'all. Hot somebody. Who's the corporate behind it though? Okay. And this kind has a name. It has a name. And you gotta make sure you start calling it. Okay, y'all maybe y'all didn't catch that. Okay. When Jesus made the disciples get in the boat, some accounts in the gospel said, it said he told them to get in the boat. And then it said he made them to get in the boat. Okay? And it says when they took off, he had already told them, let us cross over to the other side. He was crossing over to the other side because it was a kind of legion that now had to be dealt with in that region. And so when the storm came up, Jesus was looking at the disciples to deal with that kind. Okay. All right. Mo, I'm trying to flow off this here. Okay. He said, now, you got to understand now. Why would I get up and rebuke something if I was the one responsible for it happening?
Somewhere and somebody knocking on your door.
nothing to do with where you are. Let them keep knocking. Don't answer. Because unfortunately, 9 times out of 10, when you open the door, you're going to take the package. No, let me change that. Thank you, Lord. Zero. When you open the door, you're going to be mature enough to deliver them from carrying packages like that. Y'all didn't get that. We get ready, man, this man. Say, I am. An agent of change. Say, I am.
An agent
for change. Say, I am.
An agent
of change. Say,
I am
an agent
for change.
Now somebody explains of and for. Okay, y'all take too long. If you want to be an agent for change, then you first have to be an agent. Y'all just got it. See, the Holy Spirit don't just say things just to be saying them. So if you want to be an agent for change, then first you got to be a recipient of the agent of change. And what that happened is, it's hard to be an agent for change when you haven't been a recipient of the agent of change. And so that's what Jesus done. He taught. He taught, he preached, and then he demonstrated. He was just not an agent of change. He was an agent. Can we fast forward for the next 5 minutes and then we're going to get up out of here? For the next 5 minutes, let's fast forward for a minute. Let's fast forward. Okay. Jesus, 3.5 years. Three and a half years. Jesus, 3.5 years of ministry. John said they had recorded everything that he had done in John's account, gospel. He said they had recorded everything, it wouldn't have been enough books to pertain what he done. Okay. Three and a half. So to become a rabbi and walk in your kingship, you have to be 30. Even though he was king from the beginning, right? At 30, he started now. This don't mean that he wasn't, before he got 30, he wasn't doing and about his father's business. And from 30 to 33 and a half. 3.5 years. You try it off the side. 3.5 years. Okay. He never deviated or took a detour from what the Father sent him to restore. He never lost sight of the cross. All right, I need I need y'all to hold on to y'all weaves and your topiques. Okay? The cross was not his purpose for coming. Or this gonna take some swallowing here. Because the cross has a means to an end. We ain't saying that the cross didn't have a great significance in his coming. But it couldn't have been his purpose for coming because the cross has a means to an end. I need y'all to think on that for a minute now. Ponder on it. But he stayed focused on teaching and preaching this one message. Even though he talked about a lot of things, you see being recorded, he preached, he taught, he said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Okay? Alright? So now, the cross is a means to an end. But the kingdom is forever. The kingdom is forever. Okay? In the old covenant, that was a saying. Okay, live forever. Now, with your thinking, you know that a human king can never live forever. Oh boy. But your successor can keep the kingdom manifested in the earth forever. Now we ain't talking about an earthly king. We talking about an eternal king. 3.5 years. He healed the sick. And when we say he healed the sick, it's not limited to one person. Here it is. He raised the dead. That is not limited to one person. Okay, okay. Can y'all get a Holy Ghost? Just give him about 5 more minutes because that word death and some portions of the scripture, this is what death means. This is what it's meaning. And in the old covenant, Leviticus and a couple other places, and I'm going to get all the scriptures for you later on in the teaching. You'll better understand the prodigal son now. When you go read the prodigal son in Luke 15, I think it is, when you go read the lost son, we call him the prodigal son. When the father made that statement, when Jesus made that statement in that parable, when he said, my son who was dead is now alive, what he was saying was, whenever you were taken out of your region, of your territory, of your land, it was called that you was dead. That meant death. You were separated from your original homeland. Boy, I'm telling you, all, when you start studying and you really start getting into this was the Hebrew culture, that whenever they were uprooted from their land, their original land and territory, they considered that to be death. And so now, when the prodigal son came to himself, because it said he went to a foreign country or a foreign land and made himself a citizen to that country. And in the father's sight, he was dead. Ah, glory. Ah, glory.
to teach it right here. And so when we say he raised the dead, now he physically raised the dead, we understand that. But how many people, God Almighty, did Jesus bring back to their home country? And still, y'all better hear the Holy Spirit tonight, and still bringing them back. Glory to God. And you selling for a piece of property where you reside. I'm not y'all saying, I'm done. I'm done because I'm about to get off here. I'm done. I'm telling you, we are missing it. We are missing it and don't even know we're missing it. Hey! Peter Andrew! Hey! I'm telling you, when you follow me, I'm going to give you something greater than a boat in a fishery business that's international. I'm going to give you your whole land back again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit been telling us, go back to some of these scriptures and go back and exhaust it if you can. I'm telling you, it's coming so fast now. It's just coming so fast. That's why I try to buy the Spirit of God to contain itself. But when you have left from the station and they are still trying to get the tickets, and you already in motion to the place, and they still arguing about the tickets. I keep seeing in visions. I don't have dreams, but I do have visions. I keep seeing Deacon Farmer. I keep seeing people giving me large sums of money. I just keep seeing them putting it in my hand. And every time Moody put it in my hand, the Lord said, the Spirit of God tell me when I wake up, he said, I can trust you. He said, because you ain't going to spend it on you. He said, because I'll try you with the least, with the little. And he said, when somebody sows something to you, you always sowing it in somebody else. He said, I know you don't understand. He said, I know you don't call yourself apostle. He said, but I can bring it and lay it at your feet. And you will distribute it equally among the people in spite of them not thinking that they should get it. Now I say like the Spirit of God said through Pastor Brown. I ain't saying that God couldn't have had nobody up this region to do what he sent him up here to do. I'm just telling you what he told me to do. Now what he told you to do, be like the Nike commercial. Yes. And we still y'all stand. Spirit of God gonna say again, because he gonna keep on saying it and tell everybody really hard and diligently to his voice. If you got the wrong people in your ear, you better get them out. I did not tell you by the Spirit of God stop loving. I say if you got the wrong people in your ear and they are not in sync with what God is speaking by the Spirit through your leader of the Holy Ghost, you need to get them out your ear quickly and in a hurry. And if you don't understand something that the Lord has given the tier of the order of leadership, you make sure you continue to seek him with all your heart. And if he desires to reveal it to you, he will. But if he don't, just trust. That he's doing it for your good. And my good, and all of our good. Because there shouldn't be no doubt. Because when you've been with somebody for a length of time, you shouldn't allow somebody's words to now change what now you've experienced with them through the years. And that's how the enemy is getting a lot of us. You will take what somebody say in a moment in time because they got a problem with a person. And you will be with them all them years and you know their character. You know their nature. And you will take a word right then. That's how the enemy gets you out of place. That's how he gets you. I told you. I don't want that. Some of y'all, I'm still trying to get something to you in the same way Mo's doing. I'm speaking with him because I got the mic. He don't. We ain't trying to get nothing from you. We're trying to get something to you. I tell you, keep getting out your ears. Because all they're doing is trying to derail you. I'm telling y'all, I already peeped over.